This is Concept Tree Classes and today we'll deal with Chapter 7 from the book Social and Political Life 3 of Class 8 NCERT, Understanding Marginalization. Unit 4, Social Justice and the Marginalized, consists of two chapters, Chapter 7, Understanding the Marginalization, and Chapter 8, Confronting Marginalization. In this video, we'll be dealing with Chapter 7. So first we'll see what does it mean to be socially marginalized, and then we'll be studying about two communities that are considered to be socially marginalized in India. The first one are the Adivasis. We'll also see how we represent or stereotype Adivasis, the development of Adivasis. Then we'll discuss about the minorities and marginalization and about the second community which has been marginalized in India, which are the Muslims. So first let's see what does it mean to be socially marginalized. Now the term marginalization means exclusion. That is, it is a treatment of a person or a group as insignificant. So marginalization can be defined as an act of relegating, that is lowering someone to an unimportant position or a powerless position within a society or a group. For example, some of you might have probably experienced in your classroom or playground that you are not like most of the people in your class. Your taste in music or films might be different. Your accent might stand out from others. Sometimes you might be less chatty and you might play the same sport like your classmates. In such a case, we'll feel like we are excluded from the society. Similarly, in the workplaces or when you do a job, you may be excluded for certain reasons. So such a situation where a group of people are forced to live on the sidelines rather than the mainstream are termed as marginalization. Now this marginalized group exists nearly everywhere, and there are people who are denied involvement in economic, political and cultural social activities, and they are being marginalized because they might either speak a different language, they may follow different customs. Sometimes they might belong to different religious group, or sometimes if they are poor, they are considered to be a low of social status. So because of all this, the people are marginalized. And these marginalized groups are viewed with great hostility and fear. They are seen in a very unfriendly manner. And this sense of difference and exclusion leads such communities not to have access to their resources and opportunities, and their inability to assert the rights as well. They experience a sense of disadvantage and powerlessness against the dominant sections of the society who are wealthy, better educated and politically powerful. Hence, in simple words, we can say that the economic, social, cultural and political factors work together to make certain groups in the society feel marginalized. So as we said earlier, in this chapter we'll be studying about two communities that are considered to be socially marginalized in India. So the first one are the Adivasis. Now the term Adivasis literally means original inhabitants. They are the communities who lived and often continue to live in close association with the forest. Now tribals are also referred to as Adivasis. And scheduled tribes is a term used for Adivasis by the Indian government. That is the government of India. They have used the term scheduled tribes for Adivasis. And the scheduled tribes are often grouped with scheduled caste in the category of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Now around 8% of India's population is Adivasis. And many of India's most important mining and industrial centers are located in Adivasi areas like Jamshedpur, Rourkela, Bokaro and Bhilai. See, if you notice a map, you can find where all the Adivasi population is more. Adivasis are not a homogeneous population. That is, they are not a population of the same kind or they don't look alike. There are about 500 different Adivasi groups in India. Adivasis are seen mostly in the states like Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, and in the northeastern states of Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, and Tripura. For example, Odisha. Odisha itself have more than 60 different tribal groups. So we can say that there are a large number of Adivasi groups in India. Now these Adivasi societies are almost most distinctive because there is a very little hierarchy among them. There is all were same in their system. And this made them radically different from the community who believed in caste. Now let's see what is the religion of Adivasis. Adivasis practice a range of tribal religions that are different from Islam, Hinduism and Christianity. They often involve the worship of ancestors, village and nature spirits like mountain spirits, river spirits, animal spirits, etc. Now the village spirits are often worshipped at specific sacred groves within the village boundary and the ancestral ones are usually worshipped at home. Additionally, these Adivasis have always been influenced by different religions that existed around them like the Shakta, Buddhist, Vaishnava, Bhakti and Christianity. Now apart from that, many Adivasi religions themselves have also influenced the religions that existed around them. For example, the Jagannath cult of Odisha, the Shakti and the Tantric traditions in Bengal and Assam. So these Adivasi religions have influenced some of the dominant religion that existed around them. And in the 19th century, a lot of Adivasis converted to Christianity, which has emerged as an important religion in the modern Adivasi history. Now let's see the languages of Adivasi. Adivasis have their own languages. Some of them are as old as Sanskrit and they have deeply influenced several Indian languages like Bengali. Now among this Adivasi languages, Santali has the largest number of speakers. That is, most of the people spoke Santali and has a large number of publications including magazines on internet or in e-zines. Now this is an Olchiki script written by a Santali singer and this is his work. Now let's say about Adivasis and stereotyping. Now stereotyping means how we represent Adivasis or how we view Adivasis. Now in India, we usually showcase Adivasis in particular ways. For example, you might have seen in school functions or other official events or in books and movies, these Adivasis are invariably portrayed in very stereotypical ways. For example, in colorful costumes, headgears, throughout their dancing and all. Besides this, we know very little about their lives and this often wrongly leads the people to believe that they are exotic, they are primitive and backward. And often the Adivasis are blamed for the lack of advancement as they are believed to be resistant to change or to new ideas. And this also led to discrimination. Now let's say about Adivasis and development. As we have studied, forests were very important to the development of all the empires and settled civilization in India. For example, we studied in history how the forests were important during the British rule in India. Because metal ores like iron ore, copper, gold and silver, coal, diamonds, invaluable timber, medicinal herbs, animal products like wax, honey, animals themselves like elephants, that were very important in imperial armies, they all came from forest. In addition with this, the continuation of life depended heavily on forest as well because the forest recharged many of India's rivers along with the availability of quality air and water. So till the 19th century, a major part of our country was covered with forest and the Adivasis had a deep knowledge of access to as well as control over most of these vast tracts through the forest. So this meant that they were not ruled by large states or empires. That is, they were not controlled by any one, any government or any empire. Instead, these empires depended on Adivasis for their access to forest resources. Now this is quite different from what we thought about Adivasis, right? We think like Adivasis are marginal and powerless communities, but in fact they were very strong till the 19th century. Now in the pre-colonial world, Adivasis were hunters, gatherers and nomads. They lived by shifting agriculture or by cultivating in one place. But for the past 200 years, the Adivasis have been forced to migrate to live as workers in plantations, at construction sites, in industries as well as domestic workers. Now, why were they forced to migrate? They were forced to migrate due to the economic changes, because of the forest policies, the political force applied by the state, and many private industries like mining industry and all. And for the first time in history, these Adivasis did not have direct access or control to the forest territories. Now let's take the instance of Jharkhand. From 1830 onwards, Adivasis from Jharkhand and near areas moved in large numbers to various plantations in India, as well as in Mauritius, Caribbean and even Australia. Now India's tea industry, it became possible with their labor in Assam. And today there are 70 lakh Adivasis in Assam alone. And the story of this migration was full of extreme hardship, torture and heartbreak, as well as death. For example, in the 19th century alone, 5 lakh Adivasis had perished in these migrations. So more and more forest lands have been cleared for timber, for agriculture purposes and industries. The Adivasis who have lived in areas that are rich in minerals and other natural resources, those lands were taken over for mining and other large industrial projects. For example, this photo of the Niamgiri Hill is located in a district of Odisha. This area was actually inhabited by an Adivasi community, and it was like a sacred mountain for this community. And a major aluminium company, they was planning to set up a mine and a refinery over there, which would displace this Adivasi community. And but the Adivasis, they strongly resisted to this proposed development and have been joined with so much environmentalists. But the case against the company is also pending in the Supreme Court. So these powerful forces, they have often colluded to take over the tribals, and their land were often taken forcefully, even without following the proper procedures. And more than 50% of the persons displaced due to mines and mining projects are tribals. And the recent survey says that about 79% of the persons displaced from the states of Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Odisha and Jharkhand are also tribals. And huge tracts of their lands have also gone under waters of hundreds of dams that have been built in independent India. That is, because with the construction of dams as well, many of the tribal lose their livelihood, which were the forest. In Northeast, their lands remained highly militarized. And India has about 104 national parks covering about 40,501 square kilometer, and 543 wide sections covering 118,918 square kilometer. So these all were actually the land of the tribals, but they were evicted from there. And if they continue to stay in this forest, they were termed as encroachers. As the tribals lost their land and access to the forest, they lost their main sources of livelihood as well. As a result, many Adivasis, they migrated to cities in search of work, where they were employed for very low wages in local industries, buildings and construction sites. Thus, they got caught in poverty and deprivation. About 45% of these tribal groups in rural area and 35% in urban areas live below the poverty line. And this led to deprivation in other areas as well. Many tribal children were malnourished. The literacy rates among the tribals were also very low. And when the Adivasis are displaced from the land, they lost much more than the source of income. They even lost their traditions and customs as well. Now, there always exists a connection between the social economic dimensions of the tribal people. So destruction in any one of them would affect the other as well. And often this process of this displacement can be painful and violent as well. The next topic is minorities and marginalization. As we have studied, the Constitution provides safeguards to religious and linguistic minority as a part of our fundamental rights. Now the term minority is most commonly used to refer the communities that are very small in number with the rest of the population, and it encompasses or specifies issues of power, access to the resources, and has social and cultural dimensions as well. In Unit 1, we already saw how the Indian Constitution recognized that the culture of the majority would influence the society as well as the government So in such cases, the size can be a disadvantage, and that would lead to the marginalization of very smaller communities. Thus, the Constitution provides safeguards to protect the minority communities. And under certain conditions, these small communities, they may even feel insecure about their lives, their assets and well-being. And this sense of insecurity may get very prominent or would increase if the relation between the minority and the majority communities are compared. Now, the Constitution provides these safeguards because it is committed to protect India's cultural diversity and promote equality as well. In Chapter 5, we saw how the judiciary plays a very important role in upholding the law and enforcing the fundamental rights. So if every citizen of India, if they feel that their fundamental rights have been violated, they can approach the court. So now let's understand the marginalization in the context of Muslim community. Muslims and marginalization. Now, according to 2011, the Muslims are about 14.2% in India's population. Compared to other communities, Muslims are considered to be marginalized community in India. And over the years, they have been deprived of the benefits of the socio-economic development. So let's consider the situation of Muslim community with regard to the basic amenities, literacy and public employment. And let's see how the Muslims were deprived of these benefits. So first let's see the table which shows the access of different religions to basic amenities based on 2008 and 2009. So the basic amenities was the Pakka house, electricity and tap water. For Hindus it is about 65.4, 75.2, 43.7. Muslim 63.8, 67.5, 35.8. Christian 69.3, 86.2, 48.0. Sikh 91.3, 96.0 and 49.3. So if you see these numbers, we can understand that the Muslims had the least access to the basic amenities. Now let's see the literacy rate by religion based on 2011 report. The Hindus were 63, Muslims were 57, Christians 74, Sikh 67, Buddhists 71 and Jains 86. Here also Muslims had the least. Now let's see the public employments of Muslim in percentage. So the population was 13.5%, only 3% became IAS officers, IPS at 4%, IFS 1.8%, the public sector unit 3.3%, PSU 10.8% and RBI banks 2.2%. So from this data we can understand the situation of Muslim communities. So recognizing that the Muslims were lagging behind, the government set up a high-level committee in 2005, chaired by Justice Rajinder Sachar. This was Rajinder Sachar. The committee examined the social, economic and educational status of the Muslim community. So the report discussed in detail the marginalization of the community. It stated that on the range of economic, social and educational indicators, the situation of the Muslim community is comparable to that of many other marginalized communities like the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. For example, the average years of schooling for Muslim children between the age of 7 to 16 is much lower than many other communities. So economic and social marginalization experienced by the Muslims had other dimensions as well. Like other minorities, the Muslim customs and practices were sometimes quite different from the mainstream. For example, some, not all Muslims, they may wear a burqa or a sport, a long beard or wear a fez. And these became the ways to identify all the Muslims. And because of this, they tend to be identified differently. And many people, they tend to think that they are not one of us. So this became an excuse of discrimination and many Muslim families find it hard to even get a house because of this. So this social marginalization of Muslims in some instances led them to migrate from the places they lived. So sometimes this prejudice even led to hatred and violence. So this marginalization is a very complex phenomenon that needs a variety of measures, strategy and safeguard to redress such situation. So what should we do? All of us need to protect the fundamental rights of others given in the Constitution. So without these, we will never be able to protect the diversity that makes our country unique, nor we could promote equality for all. So what did we study in this chapter? We have tried to understand what it means to be marginalized and the experiences of such marginalized communities. What all were the reasons for each of these communities to be marginalized? How they experienced disadvantage, prejudice and powerlessness. The marginalization also resulted in having low status and not having equal access to education and other resources. We saw how these groups had a very long history of struggle and resistance. And marginalized communities, they wanted to maintain their cultural distinctiveness while having access to rights, development and other opportunities. So in the next chapter, we'll read about how the different groups have confronted this marginalization. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.